a particular pleasure, personal pleasure and privilege to be able to introduce Daniela Nagy. Dr. Nagy has been our own personal PhD student, not personal, but our own student at Westminster, but they're all personal, they're all mine, PhD student at Westminster, and also lecturing at Westminster, and that was last year, and this year has been employed by Queen Mary. And then you see she can't keep far, so she's coming back. And Daniela has this strand of research which is particularly important, I think, and it is about violence, especially gender violence in armed conflict. And she's looking at particular cases, but also has an overarching understanding of the sensitivities of the issues. And Daniela has published quite widely on this, and also she's very much involved with activism on the particular in the particular area. So Daniela, female identity, all yours.
Okay, thank you very much for the kind introduction. It's a pleasure to be back and to see so many familiar faces. And yes, Barbara and so many of you. No, thank you for coming today. I really appreciate it. It makes me feel more at ease in a way. So yes, thank you for coming. Yes, so I'll start my talk briefly with an overview of what has happened in this field of international law in relation to wartime sexual violence. So I'll spend about 15 minutes or so just to give you an overview and a bit of a background as to how this area has developed, because there has been a lot of movement. And it is also a very topical area, and then I'm going to try and put my angle on it and reflect on what I think some of the persistent problems still are in relation to international wartime sexual violence jurisprudence. Okay, so international criminal law has traveled a far way, has traveled a long way, and women's human rights, if you will, or the encapsulation of gender-based violence and the recognition that gender-based violence is now almost a feature of every modern-day armed conflict, has very much been acknowledged by international criminal law, by the media, by, again, many different NGOs who are very active in this field, by the United Nations, of course, and not least because of the, if you will, landmark jurisprudence established by international criminal tribunals, who've played a key role in making sure that this topic becomes visible. So what I've done is here, I've juxtaposed a couple of faces. Now, these are all people, relatively high profile, perpetrators of wartime sexual violence. You see here Mr. Furunjia, Kunarac, Delic. Then, of course, we have Mr. Karadzic, who was the former Bosnian Serb president, and Mr. Milosevic, who was the president of Yugoslavia. And next to that, I've superimposed the image of one of the few women who's actually been prosecuted for wartime sexual violence, Pauline Niamarishugo. I always have trouble pronouncing her surname, but she was one of the few female leaders who was prosecuted by the ICTR, so that's the Tribunal for Rwanda, for, again, various acts of wartime sexual violence. The reason why I have superimposed her image next to all these male leaders is because I think we need to focus more on that type of violence as well, if you will. So violence perpetrated by females. And we have to, I think, also reconceive or reconceptualize the way we look at female agency in these types of situations. I think at the moment female agency is not portrayed strongly enough in international criminal tribunals, because the main focus is on male violence against women, male sexual violence against women, very little focus on female violence against other females, or also on men perpetrating sexual violence against men, other men. Okay, briefly a few statistics. So since the end of the World War, World War II, there have been about 248 armed conflicts in 153 locations around the world. So these are statistics from the Bloomberg School of Public Health, 2013. So just to give you a flavor of how prevalent rape is, So in Colombia, you know, in the long-standing armed conflict in Colombia, rape was reported in about 11% of cases. 19% of surveyed women in Burundi had been raped, and 39% of women surveyed in Rwanda by various agencies, NGOs, UN agencies, also reported to have been raped during the genocide, which the ICTR, of course, focuses on, the genocide that took place in 1994. Okay, now, briefly, I mean, we all know about the UN Charter, of course, of 1945, and I'd say that probably the UN Charter is maybe the first step towards a recognition, or it opens a space for feminist engagement with international law, and primarily through the recognition of the principle of equality between men and women, which is stated in the preamble, also through the international community's emphasis on the principle of non-discrimination, so women and men ought to be treated equally, with the aim to ensure universal respect for fundamental human rights without distinction as to race, sex, language, or religion. So again, we see a somewhat perhaps mild or initial recognition of the fact that women are to be treated equally to men. And yes, so the UN Charter started disseminating these ideas. We then have the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which is a non-legally binding instrument. It's only a declaration, so to speak. But many would say it has a normative status in international law. It is, if you will, perhaps the Bill of Rights in international human rights law. And that, again, very strongly reiterates the prohibition on sex discrimination on account of these different identity categories. So again, we see a recognition that females are to be included, if you will, into the general framework of international law. And again, men and women of full age without any limitation due to race, nationality, religion, and so on, ought to have equal rights, and also equal rights to marriage, of course, which perhaps at the time was rather a bold statement. We also had the establishment of a Commission on Human Rights and the Commission on the Status of Women. These are UN agencies which are still operational today and which are responsible for essentially making sure that these human rights standards are implemented in various states across the world. And inbuilt within that framework is, of course, equality of women with men, rather than perhaps more protective measures, which conceive of women solely perhaps as mothers or victims or wives. Okay, so there's a formal equality as replacing protectionism as a dominant approach. And I'm also referring to the kind of protectionism that we see in international humanitarian law, for example, where women are frequently referred to in terms of their, again, perhaps somewhat victimized status during armed conflict, and where notions of honor are often attached. So we shouldn't rape women, or we shouldn't commit violence against women because it would be a violation of their honor. And many feminists have argued that this is very very patronizing towards women. And then we have probably, well, the most significant achievement, certainly on a legal level, in relation to the elimination of violence against, or not violence, but all forms of discrimination against women, and that's CEDAW. So it's also known as the Women's Convention, and that is, of course, a legally binding instrument that I believe almost all states, except for two, the United States being one of them who hasn't signed up to it, have signed up to. Okay, so that's almost universally ratified. It was drafted in 1979. Interestingly enough, it doesn't mention violence against women. Okay, and that's still a gap in international law today. We don't have a legally binding instrument that prohibits violence against women specifically. So it calls for universal gender equality, and it also requires the elimination of laws and institutional practices. So again, state bodies that have institutional codes that violate the core of human rights principles of equal rights and respect for human dignity. And certainly from a feminist perspective, its main achievement probably lies in the articulation of gender equality and state responsibility, also that states have to assume responsibility for any acts against women or for any institutional discrimination against women. And this, of course, these principles apply to all states that have ratified CEDAW. So its drafters have challenged the conceptual boundaries of human rights law by explicitly constituting the universal subject as a woman, while strongly endorsing at the same time affirmative action principles. So again, also reiterating that sometimes it will be necessary perhaps to proactively or to engage in a sort of if you will, what's the word I'm looking for? Well, affirmative action, so essentially a type of positive discrimination against women. So where women sometimes will be favored in certain, you know, maybe employment scenarios over men because they are women. Okay, so again, an explicit recognition of women, of the woman as a universal subject of international law, which was not the case previously. And also, CEDA, I'd say, is based on notions of substantive equality. Yeah? So achieving also equal employment, providing women with equal health care to men, etc., etc. It also rejects the boundaries between public and the private sphere, which again, often violence against women is committed in the private sphere. So domestic violence, as we know, is prevalent in many countries across the world. And that is violence generally that is not very visible or that international law has not engaged with very much. So that private-public divide is often seen as inhibiting the advancement of women. So that dichotomy often established by international law very often also perpetuates protective ideas about women as again victims and so on. Okay, so yeah, and this again, and I think important to stress that CEDAW requires states to take responsibility for the treatment of women. We then had a declaration on the elimination of violence against women. Again, it's not legally binding, so the CEDAW committee realized that something had to be done about this lacuna, about this gap in international law, where you simply didn't have an explicit recognition that violence against women is a problem of international law and that states need to prohibit it and to proactively work in order to eliminate this practice. But we have a declaration in place, which again is a normative or provides a normative standard. And there are now very active moves to incorporate violence against women, to make it legally binding under the Istanbul Convention, which is the most recent treaty that states have been working on. But at the moment, it's only been ratified by 8 states, and you need 10 ratifications to make it legally binding. So at the moment, still, violence against women is not a not been incorporated in any international treaty. And again, so here we have just briefly an affirmation of the fact that violations of human rights of women in situations of armed conflict are also violations of the fundamental principles of international human rights law and international humanitarian law. So in other words, that wartime sexual violence or gender-based violence against women in armed conflict is also a violation of international human rights law. So it's if you will, it's a universal problem that impacts everybody and that absolutely needs to be recognized. And in many ways, that paved the way for other developments which have been very significant for women. So we have a UN Special Rapporteur on violence against women in place. This is Radhika Kumaraswamy, but she was the first UN Special Rapporteur appointed in 1994. Today it's Rashida Manju, a South African lawyer who has taken on that role. And you know, that is a very significant mandate because these rapporteurs, of course, go around the world, collect information about violence against women, talk to governments, have direct access to state officials, and of course issue recommendations and measures to states to remedy the situation on the ground. Just briefly, so all of these developments, in addition to the Vienna Declaration, which I don't have much time to discuss, but that was another declaration that was very fundamental for women's human rights. We then see the creation of the international criminal tribunals, and the first one was, of course, well, Rwanda and Yugoslavia were more or less established at the same time, and we really see an explosion of lawmaking intended to govern armed conflict. And we also see a rapid development of international sexual violence prosecutions. So there was a real sense in the early 1990s that the problem had become so persistent and international law had been so silent for such a long time on incidents of rape and other forms of sexual humiliation against women that something had to be done very urgently. And of course, the other reason I argue why the International Criminal Tribunal for Yugoslavia in particular was so quick to focus on sexual violence is because it was, of course, in the heart of Europe as well. So there were women who were being raped in the heart of Europe. This was a conflict which wasn't very far away from us. So something had to be done very quickly about it. So yes, and the tribunal was established by a UN Security Council resolution, 827, in 1993. So unlike the ICC today, the International Criminal Court, it wasn't established by a treaty, but it was mainly a UN Security Council mandate, with states agreeing that, again, this tribunal had to be set up in order to prosecute perpetrators who had committed various acts of international, well, various violations of international humanitarian law and human rights law as well. It's based in The Hague, as you probably know, and it has a very specific subject matter jurisdiction, its own rules of evidence as well, and it's also very heavily, the rules of evidence, we can argue, are very heavily driven by feminist efforts. So feminists, for the first time, were very active in actually helping to draft some of these rules and also shaping perhaps the way in which the jurisprudence then subsequently evolved. So yes, I mean, for example, we have so rape being recognized as being you know a grave breach. For example, or also recognizing that the Geneva Conventions can apply to sexual violence offenses. So that sexual violence crimes are grave breaches of the Geneva Conventions. This was, again, perhaps the first time that an international tribunal recognized that explicitly, so that it wasn't just things like torture, for example, or different forms of murder that constituted grave breaches of international humanitarian law, but also that sexual violence fell within that definition. So the reason why the jurisprudence or why the statute of the ICTY is important for the feminist movement, certainly, or for the women's human rights movement, was that it broadened the criteria which served to establish whether there's a widespread or systematic attack against a civilian population. And it also incorporated, for example, sexual violence into the definition of enslavement. So also arguing that, yes, when women are, you know, captured and held in slave-like conditions and also sexually abused for a prolonged period of time, then that itself constitutes a form of slavery or enslavement, which is another grave breach of the Geneva Conventions and a crime against humanity, which again can occur both inside armed conflict and also outside armed conflict. So it's been very significant. And yeah, just some statistics in terms of the cases that this tribunal has prosecuted. So at today, as of today, 75 cases in total have been completed. Of these, about one third, so 24, include multi-accused cases involving sexual violence against victims. And in 16 of 24 cases, sexual violence was found by the court or agreed by the accused to form part of a systemic or widespread attack against the civilian population. And there's still about 20 cases ongoing today. Briefly, Rwanda was again established, almost at the same time as the Yugoslav tribunal. Its subject matter jurisdiction refers to internal conflict only. So, because Yugoslavia, unlike Rwanda, Yugoslavia was conceived of in the Tadic case as an international armed conflict, which meant that the prosecution had more scope to prosecute. So different types of crimes could be prosecuted. So its jurisdiction was wider than that of the ICTR, which is limited to only prosecuting sexual violence offenses that occurred during an internal armed conflict, because this wasn't arguably an international armed conflict. So Article 3 of the Geneva Conventions and Additional Protocol 2 of the Geneva Conventions apply to that tribunal. Akayesu has probably been the most important case that Rwanda has, or the Rwandan tribunal has prosecuted. Why? Because it recognizes for the first time that consent is irrelevant as in relation to a coercive situation where women are threatened with rape. So consent is irrelevant for acts of a sexual nature with a nexus to genocide, armed conflict, and crimes against humanity. And this judicial insight is pioneered in Akayesu, is becoming increasingly accepted in international criminal law, although it is not without criticism, because it also, again, perhaps reiterates the fact that women actually lack agency at all times in a situation of armed conflict. Again, about half of 24 cases that have been completed include multi-accused cases. And I say multi-accused because there are usually a number of perpetrators that that have been involved in various acts of sexual violence against women. So it's often gang rapes situations in detention centers or in certain villages or communities where there were several perpetrators who might have raped a woman. In 9 of the 13 completed cases involving sexual violence, the violence was found again to be part of a widespread pattern as well, and a systematic attack directed against the civilian population. I won't talk about the Beijing platform, but yes, and then of course we have the ICC, the first permanent international criminal court. And that was established by a treaty, so the Rome Statute governs this, it is today a permanent international court. It started prosecuting the first crimes on July 1st, 2002. Its jurisdiction is complementary to national criminal jurisdictions, which is often misunderstood by people, or certainly if you read the popular press and so on, there's very little understanding, I believe, that this is a complementary mechanism to national criminal jurisdictions. So only in cases where states are unable to prosecute these crimes, or where they're perhaps unwilling to do so, and where the UN Security Council believes that it is necessary for it to refer a matter to the International Criminal Court, will that court step in and prosecute individuals. Now, the criticism, of course, in relation to this tribunal is that at present, most of the individuals who are being tried by this court are African leaders or former African leaders. So there's a very kind of, it seems, a bit of an Africa-centric focus at the moment by this tribunal. But again, and it also, of course, depends on whether states have actually signed up to that treaty or have ratified it or not, because the ICC does not have jurisdiction over states that have not ratified the treaty. Hence, it's unable to prosecute US leaders or Israeli leaders and so on, because these states have not ratified the Rome Statute, have not the treaty that establishes the International Criminal Court. Okay, now in terms of sexual violence, the ICC has done a lot. So the Rome Statute has for the first time actually provided definitions to rape, okay, sexual slavery and forced prostitution, forced pregnancy and forced sterilization, any other form of comparable gravity. So again, laying this down in the statute, making these crimes prosecutable without requiring the intervention of feminist activists or NGO activists and so on to come in and help and reshape the statutes as they had to do in Yugoslavia and Rwanda. So the Rome Statute is very extensive. It really has dramatically broadened the categories under which perpetrators can be prosecuted for various types of sexual violence. And it also, for the first time, provides a definition of gender to encompass sociological differences between men and women. So moving away from these biological ideas that are very centered around women's, birthing capacities or that, you know, we're very, again, patronizing towards women. So it paved the way for including non-discrimination provisions, including gender under Article 21, subsection 3 of the ICC statute. And publicly, it's indicted 32 people today. There are various people who are still in detention, various people who have been arrested but are not in the court's custody yet. And it's open investigations into these countries that are listed, again, African countries, as we see, even though there is some talk, perhaps, that perpetrators or individuals from countries like Colombia will also be prosecuted in future. So there's a clear gender justice mandate, if you will. So a core component of the Rome Statute is gender justice and equal representation, an equal measure of distribution between men and women. Also, there is an equal representation of women and of gender justice experts across all organs of the ICC. So 60% of all judges today in the ICC are women, for example. That is quite a dramatic development if we look to the past. And also, there's a victim redress mechanism. So for the first time in international law, victims can actually receive redress from an international criminal court to acknowledge the harms that they have suffered and receive reparations under that regime. Now, in terms of sexual violence charges, 70% of all cases involve some sort of sexual violence charges. And there are no sexual violence charges in 30% of cases. Now, again, the gains perhaps have been that there is a recognition of crimes against women now, also a representation of women and of gender experts, and a very already nascent development of jurisprudence and a reparations regime. But the negatives, again, are that sexual violence charges, as so often, are dropped, as, for example, in the Thomas Lubanga case, who he was a former Congolese paramilitary leader and, you know, who had initially been indicted on sexual violence charges and also conscripting child soldiers and so on. But those charges had to be dropped because the witnesses were unreliable, the evidence just didn't add up, and so the prosecution had to drop these charges. And then there have been a series of UN Security Council resolutions that have also been enacted by the UN to really reiterate the fact that women are very much now part of or violence against women in armed conflict is very much the concern of the UN now, and there has to be an active recognition and also an inclusion of women in peace and reconciliation talks, in various perhaps military units as well, because we know, of course, women are underrepresented in various armies as well, so or in the army hierarchy. So there's an inclusion, Resolution 1325 in particular is very important because it calls for the inclusion of women at all decision-making levels, both national and international, especially in conflict resolution mechanisms, because of course women are often underrepresented at the negotiating table when these peace agreements are drawn up. So Resolution 1325 explicitly recognizes and reaffirms the need to fully implement international humanitarian law and human rights law to protect women, but also to make sure that they become actors in the post-conflict process. And then we have UN Resolution 1820, also very significant in 2008, stresses that sexual violence is a tactic of war, used deliberately against civilians as part of a widespread campaign again. So really, again, a very strong development all of a sudden by UN agencies to make sure that women are visible, that armed or that sexual violence against women in armed conflict becomes a visible topic, that people discuss it, that they recognize it as a widespread, as an intrinsic problem of armed conflict, and that states also undertake measures to prevent sexual violence against women in armed conflict. So we have moved a long way from the early days of the UN Charter and from the days when there were conflicts raging in Vietnam, for example, and nothing was done about sexual violence. There was absolutely no recognition that this was a very widespread phenomenon of a conflict, of modern-day armed conflict. And just briefly, and then I'm going to go into my specific points. The last, and there was an image here, but it's unfortunately it didn't show up on the slide. It would have been of Angelina Jolie, who's of course a representative of the UN, I think, for refugees. But she's also been a very vocal campaigner on the issue of wartime sexual violence, and she was instrumental in getting drafters to draft this UN Security Council Resolution 2106, which is the sixth resolution within the span of, 13 years on women. And that's very unique. I mean, the UN Security Council never got involved with women's human rights prior to the year 2000. They weren't very interested in it. And suddenly we see this plethora of resolutions being put forth, and so again, this is about peace and security and a focus on conflict-related sexual violence, reiterating that all actors, including not only the Security Council and parties to armed conflict, but all member states and UN entities, must do more to implement previous mandates and combat impunity for these crimes. And our government as well, the UK government, is also very, very vocal on this. William Hague, went on a tour with Angelina Jolie to the Congo in April, and again reiterated the UK's strong commitment to eradicating violence against women in armed conflict. There's going to be a high-level summit in June in London on this topic. So it seems that everybody's talking about women's human rights and about wartime sexual violence and gender equality and making sure that women are actually incorporated into all these various frameworks. But my argument is that what's missing in all of these tremendous developments, and I do not want to diminish them because they are important, is that, I think two things, and essentially this is now gets on to my points, and I'm going to try and keep it as succinct as possible. Of course, I could say a lot more about it, but I understand that, you know, patience is wearing thin as well, and that we need to conclude this talk at some point. But what is missing, in my opinion, is a recognition that women can also take on different roles in armed conflict. So essentially that women are not always victims in armed conflict. Women also exercise a lot of agency in armed conflict, and they also have a power to resist their captors and those who want to perpetrate violence against them. So what I argue is that while these advancements that I've just illustrated on my slides are monumental for gender justice and also the fact that international humanitarian law has redefined so many of these crimes, and that the jurisprudence or the statutes themselves of the international criminal tribunals have reconceptualized how we look at sexual violence, I still argue that the way in which women are viewed today in international law is very partial, and it's a partial construction of women through their bodies still, through their, if you will, through their reproductive capacities, through notions of motherhood, of victimhood, and through their status as wives, and that's often very central to how international law perceives women. And also the fact that ethnicity very often plays a big part in the kind of violence or in the kind of acts that are perpetrated against women. So it plays a role in terms of what kind of violence is seen and what kind of violence is not seen. And I'm going to try and illustrate that in a bit more detail by talking to you about a case that I've kind of spent a lot of time thinking about. Let me just say something briefly about contemporary international feminist scholarship before I talk about this case. Now, my argument is that much of contemporary international feminist scholarship, in particular the so-called structuralist or universalist strand embraced by very notable, very famous scholars like Catherine MacKinnon, is very united in its reservation about critique. So there's a stool of critique, if you will, today in international feminism, because feminism, or a lot of feminists feel that they have achieved so much over the past two decades in terms of explicitly recognizing crimes against women and also helping draft these statutes, that there is a tendency today in international feminism to ignore or underestimate material dimensions of women's subordination, such as the oppression of capitalism or gender divisions of labor, which are often left out of that feminist discourse around wartime sexual violence. So there's very little recognition that women, for example, get raped in armed conflict due to their socioeconomic status. So there's very little sort of acknowledgement of that factor, little introspection of it. And critique, as various scholars like Anne Orford or Neera Yuval Davis have pointed out, is still necessary. So it is important for feminist legal scholarship to retain a sense of critique. So international criminal law is not beyond critique. And as Wendy Brown has said, critique is often perceived as being somehow dangerous because it's not conducive to the achievement of practical, institutional, and legal victories on the ground. But Wendy Brown has defended the value of critique by arguing that it's not a process of rejection, but it is one of thorough scrutiny and re-engagement. So critique is thus a practice of continued re-evaluation and renewal of the object with the aim to ultimately transform the object. So this anxiety about critique, reduction of it to dismissal or mere negativity, which many scholars have tended to do, like Catherine MacKinnon, which is very ubiquitous today in contemporary political and legal theoretical culture, is thus far from warranted, because modern interpretations, or rather misconceptions of critique, have asserted that critique signifies an evasion of judgment and is at best either irrelevant or at worst potentially destructive. And so there is very often a perception of feminist normativity being in crisis, which is often linked to a crisis of subjectivity. So how then might feminism, if you will, be normative? How might it engage in critique and political lobbying in spite of the absence of unifying truth claims about the subject? Because again, what many of these structuralist international feminist scholars have tried to argue is that all women almost in armed conflict are victims. Yeah, so there is a unifying truth, there is a unifying subject that speaks in one voice. And what Wendy Brown contests is that kind of normative assessment, if you will, because she says, well, there are no unifying truth claims in an armed conflict. There are different perspectives, different players, different types of subjectivities that we encounter in armed conflict. So according to Brown, I quote her here, dispensing with the unified subject does not mean ceasing to be able to speak about our own experiences as women, only that our words cannot be legitimately deployed or construed as larger or longer than the lives they speak from. So again, what she argues, sometimes we might have to destabilize that sort of universal woman subject, if you will, of international law. But this, it doesn't come at the benefit, or it doesn't mean that women's voices are going to be silenced. In fact, quite the contrary. Let's hear the voices of these women who maybe occupied different roles in armed conflict, who weren't just passive victims, who weren't just passive bystanders, if you will, to sexual violence, or who weren't just, not just, but who weren't only raped, but who maybe only took also different roles, or maybe also learned how to survive through that ordeal of having been raped. So what I want to do just briefly, and again, I'm conscious of time, I think there are two trends that inform current ICTY, wartime sexual violence, and again, through my reading of other tribunals, I see a similar trend in Rwanda as well, in the ICTR jurisprudence, and also actually in the jurisprudence established by the Special Court for Sierra Leone, which I've also researched to some extent. So I think there's a preoccupation with the in legal trials involving sexual violence with number one, reproducing and naturalizing dominant social norms and practices, including those that normalize women's inequality. So again, saying that women are raped because they're always unequal in every armed conflict. And international wartime sexual violence jurisprudence also rests on a dichotomized and hierarchical gendered subjectivity that is being brought into being through the law. Now, what are these different subjectivities, as Diane Otto puts it? She says one is the wife and mother, which is always very prevalent in the jurisprudence. So women can only be wife or mothers, wives or mothers, or they can be victims who need protection in times of war, during both times of war and peace. There are sometimes women who are deemed to be equal to men, or formally equal to men, but somehow those subjectivities are never highlighted in the international jurisprudence. So that victim subject, of course, is often informed by colonialist narratives of gender, as well as by notions of women's sexual vulnerability. So that woman who's formally equal to men, I haven't discovered yet in my analysis of the jurisprudence. Now, if you remember on my first slide, I showed you images of a couple of, perpetrators, and the prosecutor in Kunarats is one of those landmark, so-called landmark decisions by the ICTY, which involved systematic rape against predominantly Bosnian Muslim women by Serb soldiers in 1992. Women were held in detention camps, and children, of course, as well. And they were often subjected to very systematic rapes for a very long period of time. It was very traumatic. So women often, again, had to just subject themselves to their captors and were raped on a continuous basis. Now, the judgment has been tremendously important because it established, for example, that sexual violence against women is a crime against humanity. It also held that both sexual enslavement and rape qualify as crimes against humanity when victims are held in circumstances of detention. So again, that's been very, very significant for international human rights law, international criminal law, and so on. However, what happens, and I'm going to read a passage to you, which I believe is very indicative of how these tribunals perceive of gendered subjectivity or identity at this very moment. And I argue that the way in which these tribunals present women is through a very partial idea of the body, through the representation of female identity as inevitably rooted in victimhood. So, for example, in one of the passages in this judgment, we have a testimony to say numerous witnesses stated that soldiers and policemen would come constantly, sometimes several times a day. They would point at women and girls or call them by their names and take them out for rape. The women had no choice, and again the emphasis on no choice, but to obey those men and those who tried to resist, so some recognition that there might have been an instance of resistance, were beaten in front of other women. The girls and women were generally taken for a few hours and returned, sometimes overnight, and some of them were taken away every day. Now, female victimhood, I argue, is implied here through a purported absence absence of choice to resist the rapists. Moreover, in referring to women in the same breath as girls, yeah, so women and girls being conflated here, which is achieved rather effectively through the use of the passive verb to describe women's ordeals, any sense of resistance or female autonomy is precluded. And as some women who have testified before the trial chamber had been taken out so often by so many soldiers that they were consequently unable to assess with precision the number of times they had been raped. Now, of course, while this passage illustrates the indiscriminate nature of rape, and also, of course, the incalculable harm suffered by women, at the same time, women here are represented as the opposite of the abstract, rational, individual, male subject of international law, who can reason, who can remember, who has a good enough memory to testify. So the emphasis on their inability to remember the precise details or number of rapes implies that they have been perhaps overtaken by emotion or humiliation, characteristics commonly associated with women and suggestive of the often infantilized victim subject of international law, who is very much subjugated by her male bearer of civilization. So the male captor again becomes the central protagonist of this war, thus reinforcing the protectionist and proprietary notions of women described earlier. Now, while it is of course undoubtedly true, and we know this from evidence of sexual violence or rape trials, now victims of sexual violence do often suffer from memory loss and sometimes cannot remember exact details when faced with the very formal atmosphere of the courtroom, very repressive atmosphere of the courtroom. But it still appears that as if women's gap in memory and their inability to remember facts are central to their very subjectivity as women. So at least that is my reading of the case. Now, just briefly, and I really don't have much time to go into this. And so in the Kunarats case, what emerged subsequent or during the trial is that there were instances of consensual sexual relationships between captors and women, and I think this is again an under-recognized area of international criminal law where I think more research has to be done. So again, what leads to these relationships, and are they indeed consensual or not? But there was, you know, there were several witnesses, so testimony from several witnesses who emphasized that they had actually seen these so-called perpetrators and the women, you know, seeming to be in love. These women also were very interesting. So these witnesses who testified, because they had not been raped. Many of them were small business owners. They were still trying to go about their everyday lives, if you will, during a time of you know, very heightened danger, during a time of oppression, during a time where they could have also been subjected to the same type of violence. And what I find very interesting, and I'm hoping to do more research on this in future, is I think we need to focus on those gendered identities as well. So women who, despite the oppression of war, if you will, still manage somehow to go about their daily lives, to live on, to exercise a degree of agency, to maybe resist also what they're seeing, to resist violence. And I think a more fruitful judicial strategy, just rather than just focusing on the oppressive nature and on the victimization of women, might be also to underline the women's survival instincts in the face of such extreme circumstances. Yet instead, judges often choose to focus on female identity as closely linked to a sense of helplessness, lack of agency, and so on. As Chiseke Mbenge, who has written a terrific book on prosecutions of wartime sexual violence in Rwanda and Sierra Leone, as she has put it, in the context of her observations of the Sierra Leone Truth and Reconciliation Commission, also the tribunal that has been established to deal with violence that was committed in Sierra Leone and in Liberia, she said, the narrative of absolute and perpetual victimhood for women and girls in war and peace conceals the agency that women exercise in their multiple responses to unequal power relations and abuse. ultimately the transitional justice process and also the international criminal justice process exclude those women survivors who are unable to conform wholly to the victimhood notions adopted by these tribunals. Further, the number of absolute victimhood for women requires the absolute vilification of the male perpetrators as well. So that is, if you will, an undesirable effect as well, because this viewpoint essentially means that marginalizes men's experience of sexual violence as well, and perhaps also the fact that men can often be victims. So they're not just these evil perpetrators, but it kind of precludes male identity from the picture by labeling all men as evil perpetrators of sexual violence. And also, as she puts it, and I really like her description of the different gendered identities that she has encountered during her research of Sierra Leone and Liberia. She says, I'm going to try and find her characterization. Yeah, she says, well, what she encountered, and I think this also applies to the Yugoslav context, at least from my research. So she said that in the context of Sierra Leone, what she saw was, for example, the presence of casual boyfriends, of lovers, of merry widows, of men, again, that were perhaps in informal relationships. So again, very different independent women who went about their business. Estranged spouses, absent husbands, extended households. So all of this is also very much a feature of armed conflict. And we need to kind of start maybe reconceptualizing how we look at armed conflict or how we look at these different social arrangements within armed conflict. Okay, so I'm going to conclude now by just briefly again, and there's much more that I could say about this, but I shall not do that. So my conclusion essentially, what I think should be done, perhaps, or maybe the way forward for international criminal law or feminist legal scholarship, is that so we know women or sexual violence against women today is a very prevalent phenomenon of armed conflict. There are very strong regulatory responses that have been adopted by feminists as a result of many of these cases. But it is a structuralist, a very universalist view of women that still prevails. It is often Western feminist scholars who still have the ultimate say. I think colonialist narratives, very narrow narratives of gendered identity still, which make women's empowerment and emancipation almost impossible, still prevail. So there's a dominant feminist set of frames at play, the preoccupation with women's victimhood, really, which comes, I believe, at the normative expense of gender equality and justice. So what I wanted to do in my presentation today was to try and visibilize women's agency in armed conflict by also identifying maybe marginalized female subjectivities that have very often not formed the dominant narrative frame of the way in which we perceive conflict, the Yugoslav conflict, but also the Rwandan conflict. Because another argument I was going to make is that there was a lot more emphasis on rapes that had been perpetrated against Bosnian Muslim women, which were often described as systematic, widespread, and very much targeted at their ethnicity. Very little focus on other women who had been raped, Serbian women or Croatian women, who again also were raped, maybe not to that same systematic extent, but again whose perhaps recognition has somehow been missing. I also believe that while it is very important that international law has showcased these cases and that it has brought it to the attention of the world, I think that female agency is possible under very coercive conditions. I think it was a reality in wartime Bosnia-Herzegovina, and also in Sierra Leone and also in Rwanda. And I think perhaps that, I very much subscribe to Janet Halley's view here, that perhaps it's time to take a break from feminism or from that strand of feminism that, again, really sees women through a very subjugated lens still. And that's not as a way of diminishing its normative value, but in order to consider its own institutional investments with power and to also reassert these emancipatory purchases. Because I think attention to this type of argument may promote a more complex and insightful feminist analysis as well as make room for other discourses which may provide refreshingly new insights into questions that feminists engage with. That's it. Thank you.